Well, God's grace and His mercy and His peace be to you from God the Father and our Lord and our Savior Jesus. Good morning. Today is our today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. And as I think about that day and I think about our lesson dealing with the temptation of Jesus, it makes me realize that we face those very real temptations, sometimes in bold ways, sometimes in subtle ways. And that in the midst of them, we can turn to the one who has given us this life, this sacredness, this sanctity of life. We can turn to him because he's also the one who has called us, declared it to be through creation and through the redemption of his son Jesus, that we are his children. Now, last week we began this Epiphany season talking about the baptism of Jesus, where God declared his son, declared Jesus to be his son. We beheld the wonders and the works of all that Jesus did. We saw that he went into the water, perhaps the greatest sight of all, into the water and taking on the sins of people, becoming one with us. The Bible tells us that after that baptism in the Jordan River, that the same Spirit that descended upon him and rested upon him now led him into the desert to be tempted by the devil, the slanderer. When we look closer at this story, it's kind of reminiscent of the children of Israel, of God's imperfect son, Israel, and their journey into the desert. They had gone through the waters, and having gone through those waters, were led into the desert to be tested. The Bible would say that the Father had them go into that desert to test them, to test their faith, and to be strengthened in their identity as the children of God. They would face hunger and thirst. They would have the opportunity as they journeyed through the desert, having needs that seemingly were not met, they had the opportunity to put God to the test to see if he really did love them and care for them. They would have the opportunity to switch their allegiance and worship someone other than him. And in all those tests, Israel failed, which is why God sent his only begotten son, his beloved son, whom after having gone through the waters, not of the Red Sea, but in the Jordan River, is led into the desert not to be tested, but to actually be tempted. He faced hunger. He faced the opportunity to put his father to the test. And he had the opportunity to worship the worst idol of all, Satan himself. And in all these temptations, secure in his identity from his Father, Jesus overcame. Jesus was what Israel was not. And he kept God's command and he remained in perfect obedience to all that God had given to him. It enabled him, by doing that, to become the perfect sacrifice, to be the sufficient ransom to take away our sins. Jesus revealed himself in the temptation to truly be the Son of God. He revealed himself to be the Son of God, but he didn't have to prove it. The irony is that, in fact, he showed himself to be the Son of God by not proving it, but by living and acting secure in the identity the Father revealed to him in his baptism. Let me show you what I mean, and let's make that connection into our lives today. If you look at the scripture, Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11, I invite you to open up your Bible to that if you don't have that. You'll notice that in the first two temptations, the devil starts with the words, "If you are the Son of God." If you are the Son of God. You know, that phrase by the devil is kind of a in-your-face kind of challenge to Jesus. And what follows is essentially, if you are the Son of God, prove it. First, prove it to yourself. Prove it by your own works, by your own actions. Satan says to him, "I know you're hungry. It's been 40 days, and I know that you can do something about it. Prove yourself to be God's son by turning these rocks into bread." Jesus' response comes from the scripture. "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." In other words, there is something more important than food, the word of God, and I just used it on you. You can almost just drop the mic right there, right? But Satan continues. Satan's pretty wily. So almost in the same way he tempted Adam right at the beginning, he goes to what God said. Satan goes to the word himself, but he uses it differently than Jesus did. You see, Jesus used the word of God authoritatively and did so each time. He said, "It is written," and literally what it means is, "It stands written." It was authoritative when it was written, and it still is now. But the devil adds a little word, and unfortunately, in most of our English translations, that word is not included. But he uses a little word. In Greek, the word is auti, which means that. It's a very simple little word. But what Satan says is, "It is written that." The devil does not use the word of God authoritatively, but he misuses it, and he takes it out of context, and he misquotes it by omitting a significant portion of it. And he uses it for his own purposes, not God's. I think about that when I hear so many people use the Bible, especially people who really aren't necessarily doing what God says. They use the scripture the same way. They'll say, "You know, the Bible says that," and then they'll finish it. And then they'll go on to use it, usually out of context, to prove their own point for their own purpose instead of using it authoritatively to give God the final word instead of themselves. Something to think about the next time you hear the Bible quoted. So Satan goes to the scriptures, kind of, to essentially say, "You know, Jesus, if you won't prove it yourself, then have your Father prove it to me. And prove it to me and really to the whole nation by throwing yourself down from the temple for all to see." He brought him up to that pinnacle, and we often think of pinnacle as the high point, but the word actually comes from a word about a little wing. And so it might have been the highest point, but it also might quite likely have been on this place where the trumpet would blow for every Sabbath, a place where people would direct their attention. And Satan is saying, "Throw yourself down for everyone to see, and have your father prove by catching you before you hit the ground. Jesus' authoritative response, it stands written that you should not put the Lord your God to the test. When you look at these first two temptations, essentially the devil is saying to Jesus, So you're the Son of God. Prove it to me. Either you or your Father. You know, I can almost hear those same words said today. To me, and likely you've heard them to you as well. So, you're a child of God. Prove it to me. So, you're a Christian. Prove it. So, you're a Christian. Well, you shouldn't do this, or you shouldn't do that. So, you're a follower of Jesus. You know, didn't Jesus say this? Or Jesus say that? It becomes such an easy temptation to try to prove ourselves to others. Or maybe likely to prove ourselves to ourselves sometimes. To prove that we are a child of God by our own works, by our own efforts, by our own spirituality, by our own discipline, whatever it might be. It usually comes out when we live our lives by statements that quite often start with the words, I need to. I need to listen more. I need to help more. I need to be more patient. I need to be better at devotions. I need to watch my tongue. And the list could go on. Not that we don't need to do these things as part of our lives, as part of what God's law says, and to give a witness to others, but the reality is that these statements so easily get twisted in our thinking. And we think that I need to, because if I don't, then am I really a child of God? And we find ourselves proving our identity by our works, rather than accepting and embracing our identity as given to us by our Father in baptism. We are a child of God, not because we say so, or because we have proven it to be so. We're a child of God because He says so. It is really that simple. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. And then there are those times we are tempted to make God do more. So, you're a child of God. Well, if you are, if He really loved you, why would He let you get sick? Why would He let you lose your job? Why would He let this happen to you? If you're a child of God, if you're a follower of Jesus, then why wouldn't He have protected you from that accident or have kept you from that difficult time? And we think about it, and we might start thinking to ourselves, you know, that's a good question. And in order to silence our critics, to show the world, to prove to ourselves, we might start wondering and asking God to do something like keep us from falling and hitting ourselves against a stone. We might ask God to do something for us so that we would know and the world would know, really know, that He loves us, that we are His, and I am who I say I am. Jesus didn't play that game, either with the first temptation or the second. See, Jesus didn't need to. There was nothing to prove. Why? Because the Father had already declared it to be so in His baptism. And the Word of God was enough. At His baptism, God said, "This is My beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." Jesus was revealed and shown to be God's Son because God said so. That is enough. It was enough for Jesus. It should be. It is enough for us. We are children of God, set apart, a life that is sacred and holy. We are children of God because the Father has declared it so in our baptism. We do not have to prove it by our own power or our own works, whether it's changing rocks into bread or helping someone across the street or giving someone our place in line when we're trying to get out of the parking lot. We do not have to have the Father prove it. Throw yourself down and let Him catch you. God has already proven His love for us by the gift of His Son, Jesus. We look to the cross and God has shown His love for us. God has already proven His love for us by calling us out of this darkness and into His marvelous light. He's proven His love for us and shown us our identity because He's given us undeserved kindness that we call grace. Those are His promises to us. And by faith, we claim our identity from His Word and His promise and nothing more. To do more really becomes doubting that promise and falling in the face of temptation, which we have all done. But then we turn back to that promise. We receive His forgiveness and an assurance, an affirmation of who we are as His child. To hold to that promise and embrace this declared identity, that is what God calls us and that is what we are. To do that, that is to overcome the enemy. And that is having the power to live a life centered in the strength and the peace and the joy of God, worshiping the Lord our God and serving Him, not ourselves, not Satan, but serving Him only. Amen. And now may the peace that passes all our understanding guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen.